بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. انا دكتور تامر مصطفى، استاذ امراض القلب بجامعه الزقازيق. النهارده ان شاء الله هنتكلم على موضوع الانفكتيف اندوكارديتس، موضوع كتير معقد، مليان باسامي باثوجنز كتيره، مليان باسامي انتيبيوتكس كتيره، ولكن اخترنا ان شاء الله ان احنا ناخد رود ماب عشان نقدر نفهم موضوع معقد زي الانفكتيف اندوكارديتس. وده مرض رير ولكنه سيريوس اند كاز هاي مورتاليتي ريت. الرود ماب هيتطمن على الديفينيشنز اند جنرال انفورميشن، الكلينيكال سيمتومز، الدياجنوزز، نعرف الديوك كريتيريا، البلاد كالتشرز واليوز اوف ايكوكارديوغرافي، البيزكس اوف تريتمنت، الكومبليكيشنز اوف ا كيس اوف انفكتيف اندوكارديتس، البروفيلاكسيس، اند فاينلي السمعي. Definition of infective endocarditis: it is an inflammatory process ongoing inside the endocardium due to infection after endothelial damage, and most often involving valves are aortic and mitral valves. احنا بنقسم infective endocarditis اولا according to localization الى left sided right sided device related. في left sided it may be a native valve or prosthetic valve. لو الانفكشن ايجا في early في السنة يكون early infective endocarditis، مع البروستاتيك late يكون after one year. According to the mode of acquisition، في healthcare associated infective endocarditis يا اما nosocomial يا اما non-nosocomial، او community acquired او intravenous drug abuse associated infective endocarditis. الانفكتيف اندوكارديتس قد يكون active وقد يكون recurrent. الريكرنس في نوعين، في الريلابس وفي الريانفكشن. الانسيدنس 3-10 لكل 100,000 كيس بير يير. ماكسيمم ممكن يوصل at age of 70-80 years to have infective endocarditis. More common with women. الموست كومن باثوجين هو الستابيلوكوكس اوريس، but still the most common pathogen in the developing countries the streptococcal infective endocarditis. الكلينيكال سيمتومز اللي ممكن تقابلها الفيفر occur in over than 90% of patients. The development of new intracardiac murmur in about 85% of patients and may be present with complication like cross spots, fatigue, or glomerulonephritis, and that can occur in about 30% up to 30% of patients. When to suspect that patient have infective endocarditis: if there is a sepsis of unknown origin, if there is a fever coexisting with intracardiac implantable material, history of infective endocarditis, presence of congenital or valvular heart disease, risk factors for infective endocarditis, presence of congestive heart failure symptoms, development of new heart block, presence of positive blood cultures, vocal neurological signs but without known etiology, and it may be with peripheral abscess in kidney, spleen, vertebra, column or brain. For diagnosis, first we use Duke criteria. We need for diagnosis two major criteria or one major criterion plus three minor criteria or five minor criteria. The two major criteria are the blood culture positive for typical infective endocarditis causing microorganism, evidence of endocardial involvement. The minor criteria are predisposition like heart condition or intravenous drug abuse, fever with temperature over 38, vascular phenomenon or arterial emboli, immunological phenomenon like glomerulonephritis, osteonodes, and rosy spots, or microbiological evidence with positive blood cultures but don't meet the major criteria. These are examples of the clinical signs of infective endocarditis. This is an example for a Janeway lesions. There's an example splinter hemorrhage. And an example for osteo nodes, which are painful erythematous nodular lesions resulting from infective endocarditis. This is an example for the subconjunctival hemorrhage. And lastly, this is an example for a rosy spot. The ratio is blood cultures. Always before starting antibiotics, always we need trypanosomes for aerobic, anaerobic, and the mycotic pathogens, 10 ml each. We need 3 sets of samples. Use of echo for diagnosis. Transesophageal and transesophageal echo are used. These are fundamental importance in diagnosis, management, and follow-up. Should be performed as soon as the infective endocarditis is suspected. The sensitivity of transesophageal echo is higher than transesophageal echo, 90 to 100% versus 42-63%. And remember that transesophageal echo is the first choice to find infective endocarditis complications. So, if we have a clinical suspicion of infective endocarditis, we'll proceed immediately to transesophageal echo. If there's a prosthetic valve or endocardic device, if the quality of transesophageal echo is poor or positive, the transesophageal echo, we proceed to transesophageal echo. But if negative, we revise our clinical suspicion of infective endocarditis. If low, we can stop. If high, we proceed to transesophageal echo. But if the initial transesophageal echo is negative, with high suspicion of infective endocarditis still remains, so we can repeat transesophageal echo within 7 to 10 days. The main issue for diagnosis of infective endocarditis by echo is vegetation. But echo can also diagnose complications like abscess, pseudoaneurysm, perforation, fistula, valve aneurysm, and the hesitance of prosthetic valve. This is an example for a transesophageal echo of aortic valve showing extensive aortic valve ring abscess. The basics of treatment. Success relies on eradication of the pathogen. Use of bactericidal antibiotic regime should, and the drug choice dependent on the type of pathogen. And surgery is used mainly to cope with the structure complications. Early surgery with indications equals good survival and less mortality. The standard therapy for native valve endocarditis takes 2 to 6 weeks, while over the 6 weeks if prosthetic valve endocarditis, in cases of streptococcal infective endocarditis, we can use shorter courses like 2 week course using combination of beta-lactams and mannoglycosides. The most common antibiotics used are amoxicillin and penicillin group, with less use nowadays for gentamicin. But cases of beta-lactams allergy, we can use vancomycin. Complications that may occur with infective endocarditis, congestive heart failure, the most common complication and the main indication for surgical treatment. It occurs in about 60% of patients. Uncontrolled infection, whether persisting infection or extending to perivalvular structures. The systemic embolism to brain, spleen, and lung can occur in up to 30% of patients, and it may be the first symptoms of infective endocarditis. Neurological events, acute renal failure, rheumatic problems, and myocarditis all are complications for infective endocarditis. So prophylaxis. The first and most important is proper oral hygiene with a regular dental review, but antibiotics can be used only in high-risk group patients, like patients with prosthetic valve or foreign material used for heart repair, patients with history of infective endocarditis, congenital heart disease patients with a cyanotic without correction or with residual leakage, congenital heart disease without leakage but up to 6 months after surgery. We can use amoxicillin or ampicillin 30 to 60 minutes prior to the intervention. And the summary case of fever of unknown origin should be suspected for infective endocarditis. Blood cultures are essential for diagnosis. ECHO is the best method to monitor and follow up infective endocarditis cases. Antibiotics are the main treatment. Congestive heart failure is the most common complication. And lastly,